your favorite cartoon characters will help you understand how drugs and alcohol can ruin your life. So watch the program. Talk about it with your family.
Hi everyone, welcome to Special Presentation with Mike and Ethan, or
Alf will not be seen tonight.
Let's take a trip back to the 1980s or even the 70s and the wonderful, magical, totally forgotten ritual of Saturday morning, of how you got up early on Saturday instead of sleeping through the whole day like normal. you got up, you watched terrible cartoons with a big bowl of sugar cereal right in front of you. But in between those cartoons, there were little public service announcements to trick your parents into thinking this might be educational.
Already, like, half our audience is, like, completely baffled by this scenario.
No, I'm not making this up. This is what happened. This was the pre-internet day, before there was such a thing as an all-cartoon network. You know, cartoons were hard to come by, and you rarely got new ones. I mean, half of this Saturday morning that we're waxing so nostalgic about, it was just reruns. It was just Bugs Bunny and Tweety.
Yep. The Bugs Bunny and Tweety show, I think they called it.
Yes. And it had its own weird little title card, so they didn't have to credit anyone.
Yeah, man. Saturday morning, like, most of the cartoons were not very good. But like you said, it's the only time to get cartoons, and it was certainly much better than what you get on the Sunday morning. Those were where the real dregs went.
What did you ever see on Sunday morning? The only thing I ever saw an ad for Sunday morning cartoons was Paddington.
Paddington, like the bear?
Yes.
Huh.
Is there another Paddington?
No. I guess there's Paddington Station. I was like, maybe there's a whole cartoon show about a train station. I don't know. The British do stuff like that. The only thing I remember being on Sunday morning was Yogi's Treasure Hunt.
Yogi's Treasure Hunt.
Yeah. And then some churchy cartoons would be on or something. But I think mostly they just went straight to actual, like, church stuff. Like, they didn't really show a lot of cartoons. It would just be like, hey, here's a preacher in a mega church, so you don't have to go to a real church, because that's America.
If you're staying home sick from church, church will come to you.
It's like, oh, joy. that's great. It's exactly what I want. Saturday morning was the best that you could get. It's weekday
afternoon. Usually not that great, but still. You know.
I mean, there were a couple, like, highlights on Saturday morning. There were a few, you know, the Muppet Babies was on, the Real Ghostbusters. So there were a few highlights, but
Garfield
mostly,
and Friends.
Yeah. Oh yeah, Garfield and Friends. Yeah, you know, mostly garbage, but there were always a few good ones. Like you said, there were also these. There were also commercials to sell you consumer products and PSAs to make you think that you were learning. And most of those were about how not to do drugs, like. You know, they were like about how it was extremely cool not to do drugs. And those were so effective that it's almost like the drug industry, as in the illegal narcotics industry, lost a lawsuit and was forced to pay for anti-drug commercials. And chose a marketing agency that would make them as ineffective as possible. Which is what happened in real life to the tobacco industry. But, anti-drug commercials, not very good. You know, they were mostly telling you, like, drugs are really scary. As a 8-year-old suburban white kid, it's like, I know if I'm ever offered a, crack cocaine, I'm definitely going to say no, because that's going to happen. I'm totally going to be offered it. And then they're going to, like, be like, no, you should totally. And they're going to be very, very pushy about it as well. It's not like, you know.
Yeah, it's not. So, it's never presented as something that you would do of your own accord. It's always something that bullies goad you into doing.
Yes. And then as soon as you do, no matter what drug it is, you always have like an immediate like hallucinatory trip. You know, like you start and jump out a window. Like, I think that happened like 3 times on Gem of the Holograms.
The holograms in question were the windows.
Yeah. But you know, but apart from anti-drug commercials or anti-drug PSAs, there were also PSAs that taught you how to be healthy. And you know, like, what were these called? These were the
ABC Bod Squad, I think, is the most the best known one. That was the one that was where you got things like Nutty Gritty and Don't Be a Yuck Mouth. And the Munchies, and
yes, very very formative commercial for me when I was a kid.
Same, but there was one particular star of these. On certain episodes, you would see a bulbous yellow creature pop up and announce "Time for Timer," whatever that means, and then he'd show you how to say make those orange juice ice cubes with the toothpicks for a stick, or make a wagon wheel out of cheese and crackers.
Yeah, I remember that. And you know, as a kid, I thought that orange juice and the ice cube thing, I thought that was brilliant. I was like, this guy's a genius. This cartoon lemon's a regular Albert Einstein.
I've seen that in multiple places. I remember seeing a recipe for it in like a Disney textbook kind of thing, like a guide to fun and learning, and they even showed you how to do it on Dexter's Laboratory as well.
Oh, that sounds familiar. I mean, I feel like it's a good idea because it's the sort of thing parents will like, because orange juice is good for you. I mean, in theory, I guess it's mostly sugar. So
yeah, orange juice has more sugar than a Twinkie.
But it has vitamins,
which the Twinkie does not.
Yeah, parents think it's good for you, so they like it, and kids will like it because it's like a popsicle, which is fun to eat. You know, so I can see the appeal. Plus, it's just an I don't know. I mean, the idea that you can make a popsicle at home is, when you're a kid, that's pretty exciting.
That's,
you know,
magic.
That's like, yeah, exactly. So I really like the idea. The wagon wheel thing, I was like, well, yeah, duh, anyone can do that. It's just cheese on crackers. I mean, I eat that all the time. I would give it a name.
I'm going to show you the recipe for banana yogurt grams. Does it involve bananas, yogurt, and graham crackers? Yes, very good.
It's like, oh, thanks. Yeah, it's like, yeah, I saw that. I was like, I guess this guy's not as smart as I thought he was. But Timer, Timer was this, I always thought he was a lemon when I was a kid.
He looks like some sort of lemon or some sort of fruit or something. And He was around for literal decades. I was seeing Time for Timer stuff into the 90s. And you always wondered, like, who is this character? Why are we seeing him as if it's like, hey, it's our old friend Timer. Remember him from the three things that we show over and over again? Well,
yeah.
Today we have the answer for you. Today we are going to reveal Timer's origin story.
His villain origin story.
Do you want to know how I got this top hat?
Oh, that's right. Timer wears a top hat.
He wears a top hat, but it's sort of like it looks more like a traffic cone than anything else.
Yeah, it's like he's got this hat. It's like a stovepipe hat more than a top hat. He's got like a big bow tie and a cane. I think he's supposed to have this kind of vaudeville feel to him.
Yeah, he keeps announcing that, you know, he likes to sing and dance and tell a joke or two.
Yeah, he's like, the way his mannerisms remind me a lot of Michigan J. Frog. So
yeah,
I think that's kind of the vibe they're going for.
Yeah, he's one of the boys of chorus.
Yes, exactly. We know he knows you're rooting for us, but now he's got to go.
In his case, it'd be, I know you're rooting for pus.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's appropriate, considering what it turns out Timer actually is.
Yes. No, he's not pus. No. Okay, are you ready for what Timer is? I will give you 5 seconds to think about what this creature who recommends nutritious snacks to you could be. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. time's up. What timer is an anthropomorphic circadian clock. He is, according to him, he is the keeper of body time, who indicates in the body whether it's time to sleep or eat or work or play, which I don't think are functions of the body, but I guess he determines when you get bored too. So
yes. So I gotta say that makes his name make a lot more sense.
Yes. Since,
you know, timer didn't really make sense for a lemon. At the same time, you gotta hand it to whoever made this. If that's they're like, look, we need to teach kids about the body and health. What is going to teach them? And I would think, like, if it was me, if you tasked me with that, I don't know, an anthropomorphic like heart valve or a blood cell. But no, they're like a circadian rhythm. All right. That definitely going a little abstract there, but you know what? I can't say he doesn't look like a circadian rhythm.
That's for sure. I mean, I don't know what you imagined them to look like, but now that I know that that's what he looks like, that's what I always imagined it to look like.
Yeah. So he originally appears apparently in this 1973 special?
1973, same year as the Phantom Tollbooth.
Oh, yeah, and there is the animation styles. They both look very 70s.
Yeah, they have that super puffy Peter Max kind of almost Yellow Submarine-ish look.
Yeah, yeah. The thing where it just looks very. It's very surprising to find out the Hubleys aren't involved in this.
Yeah, everything looks like color forms.
Yeah, but it's weirded me out seeing that this was the timer's originally from 1973 and was appearing in those ads in the late 80s and, like you said, into the 90s. Did he do anything between this special and those ads? Because I feel like those ads weren't airing continuously after the special.
Actually, there is one other, but it's not available online anywhere I can find. There's a second timer special, which is called something or other Inside Red's Head. And it's,
oh, geez.
Yes, and it's not about the body this time. It's about the mind. And it's a little different in that it starts out animated to begin with. This one has live action and animation combined, but Inside Red's Head is about finding out what's going on inside the mind of a teenage Little Red Riding Hood.
Oh man, who can say in a teenager's mind?
I'm guessing the hot boy in her life is represented as a wolf. That seems pretty obvious.
Oh, okay. Well, I see where this is going. So it's one of those specials.
Yes. You know, what's happening to me?
It's, man,
you know, they have to talk about puberty without talking about the pubes.
Oh, well, okay. I'm very disappointed that we didn't get to see that one because I feel like there may be a reason it's not available online, but still. So instead we get this one where timer is called, oh my God, this is a mouthful.
It's called The Incredible, Indelible, Magical, Physical Mystery Trip.
It's 1973, ladies and gentlemen.
It's 1973, and nobody knows how to name anything anymore.
Everything is the vegetable lasagna experience, man. Everything just woo. Okay, all right.
The incredible edible egg.
Yeah. Yeah, you know what? I was kind of disappointed that nothing in that name mentions edible because I feel like that's kind of a big part of this.
Yeah, it rhymes with incredible, so it should be incredible, edible, inedible, magical, physical mystery trip.
Yeah.
But
that title really tells you nothing about what you're going to see because it really sounds like, okay, it's going to be a special on Timothy Leary or something, but no, it is basically, what do you call it? It's like inner space or.
Yeah. It's Osmosis Jones in 1973.
Oh yeah, it really is. I mean, even down to the conceit that the body is because in Osmosis Jones, they're in the city of Frank.
Yeah.
And in this one, it's the country of Carl, but
yes.
So it's about like two timer is the circadian rhythm for Uncle Carl, And he's going to take two small children, Uncle Carl's niece and nephew, on a magical journey into Uncle Carl.
Uncle Carl looks like he's maybe in his 50s or so. These kids are pretty young. There must be some major, space between him and his own siblings for these kids to have a 50-something Uncle Carl.
Yeah, I actually was curious because Uncle Carl is actually played by veteran character actor Hal Smith.
Yes.
Most people know him as
Otis the Drunk, I believe.
That's right. Otis on the Andy Griffith Show. Younger viewers may know him as the voice of Owl from Disney's Winnie the Pooh and The New Adventures of Winnie the Pooh. And he was, basically about in his 50s at this point, looking at him. Yes. And
also and fans of Special Presentation or Alf Will Not Be Seen Tonight will know him as the voice of McGillicuddy from Pontiful Puck.
Oh, really?
Yes. He was actually in a number of things that we've dealt with. He was in Garfield, His Nine Lives.
Oh, who did he play in Garfield, His Nine Lives?
He was Freddy. He was the composer.
Oh, interesting.
It was a very small role, but that was him again. And he was in the Huber Bloom Highway as the narrator.
Oh, wow.
Halloween is Grinch Night.
Oh, yeah. And also, apparently, Shinbone Alley, too.
Oh, yeah.
As the rat, who appears in, like, one scene.
One scene, yes. Freddy the Rat and Prissy Cat. I have no idea who Prissy Cat is.
Yeah, I don't remember that either. But he's definitely... He had a long and storied career. He was a working actor. And, and this one, they don't call on him to do a whole lot in this, but, I also didn't realize he apparently was the voice of Flintheart Glomgold.
On DuckTales? Wow.
Yeah, on DuckTales. Jeez, that's surprising.
Oh, wow, he was the second narrator, the old buffalo hunter in Buffalo Rider. Wow.
Wow. wow, he was... And he was working up right until the end. He also was in such beloved cartoons of the 90s as Bonkers, The Little Mermaid, Yo Yogi, and Darkwing Duck, as well as Midnight Patrol, Adventures in the Dream Zone. I have no clue what that is, but that sounds pretty badass.
Midnight Patrol, Adventures in the Dream Zone? That sounds like a really bad attempt to make a Little Nemo cartoon.
Actually, you know what? Looking at it, this actually sounds way less interesting than I thought. It is about four children and a dog. And they go to sleep at night, they turn up in the dream zone, whereas Midnight Patrol, they're appointed by the Grand Dozer to protect from nightmares and other threats. I think I actually saw this show when I was a kid. It's British.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's not nearly as good as the title Midnight Patrol would make it sound.
Yeah. Oh boy, here's another one of those great, Mickey Mouse spitting quotes. Six-year-olds just aren't content to be fobbed off with Mr. Wizard go poof and Masty Man go away. Stories these days have to be believable, contain some logical process.
What was this in reference to?
This is the creators of the show Midnight Patrol Adventures in the Dream Zone talking about how disappointed they are with modern children's television.
Oh, yeah, and Midnight Patrol Adventures in the Dream Zone is going to revolutionize. No shitty cartoons now. We've got, oh my god, talking about putting on airs. It was another dumb 90s cartoon. There was nothing special about it. It was this kids.
5.1 million watched the series in Britain, making it the second most popular children's show on British television after Neighbours.
What? Neighbors is a children's show?
No, it's a soap opera.
That's what I was going to say. I thought that, I didn't think kids were watching it, but okay.
Oh, wow. A comic strip based on the show featured in The Dandy.
Well,
Midnight Patrol is in our wheelhouse.
Oh, you know what? Maybe then next time we're going to look at... Midnight Patrol Adventures in the Dream Zone, and see if it holds up any better than when I first saw it in 1990. Well, just keeping in mind that when I was 10 years old, I thought this was garbage, so I doubt I'll have a higher opinion of it now.
Yes, but, this is, yeah, you who loved and still love dino saucers think this show is garbage. So this is going to be fun.
That's right. With dinosaurs, shut up, dinosaurs was good. but no, so anyway, we were speaking, however, of Time for Timer. Hal Smith is in this, but that's why we started derailing into him.
But, yeah, Hal Smith is in this, but more specifically, this is in Hal Smith.
Oh, that's true. That is true. So the premise is that Timer, he comes out of Hal Smith and he shrinks these two children.
Yes, I don't know why he shrinks these two children. He just offers to do it, and then they're like, "Oh, okay."
Yeah, and then he's like, "Now you're tiny," and now, oh no! And then Uncle Carl wakes up because he was asleep and just eats them, like, because they're on the rim of a coffee cup, and I guess he drinks and he swallows them.
But
and,
the coffee cup seems to be empty, so it's more like he just says, like, "Oh, there's a crumb I didn't eat."
Yeah, and for our Vore fans, it's not as sexy you would think. I mean, no, maybe it is. No. I don't know.
It's right up there with Ren getting chewed up in the episode where he dresses a mouse.
Yeah, like I don't know what makes for a good Vore scene. I think Hal Smith. No shade on him. He's not my type. He doesn't do much for me. And there's not nearly enough like maw shots and saliva to really sell this whole thing. It's just Plus, it is weird though that like he apparently swallows them, but then they're in his mouth, because they do a whole sequence when they're just in his mouth now that teaches that cavities are bad.
Well, boy, I'm glad they explained that.
Yeah, except okay, so first of all, Timer is really annoying.
Really, Timer is obnoxious. He is so much better. This is not the voice for Timer that you will know from the from the short subjects.
No.
After this one, he was replaced by, I believe, Lenny Weinrib, who is best known for creating the role but not playing Scrappy Doo.
Oh, interesting. Huh. Okay. Good for him.
I was like, oh, good. I'm glad he got work.
Yeah. It's like, well, it's Krabby Doo serves a function. So, Timer in this one, he's doing that thing. It's kind of like the genie in Disney's Aladdin, where it's just an endless stream of celebrity impressions.
Barely. Sometimes it's not even. Sometimes he's just doing an accent.
Yeah, it's. But Robin Williams can do that because everyone loves Robin Williams. He's got just the charisma to pull it off. This one, it's just like, God, this. Why won't this guy shut up?
Len Maxwell doesn't just do the voice of Time for Timer. He does the voice of every single character inside Uncle Carl.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean,
so he has more of a range than you might realize.
I mean, yeah, he's definitely good, because I didn't realize they're all the same voice. It's not his fault that Timer is obnoxious. I'm sure he was playing the character as he was instructed to do it. It's just that Timer's a bad character who's just the whole time you're just like, all right, I guess these are impressions of celebrities from like 30s vaudeville. Most of them are kind of the only one I recognized, WC Fields at one point, and I think the rest were just went over my head.
He definitely does Mammy at one point.
Oh boy. Well, very topical references in 1973.
Timer is canceled.
They're in Uncle Carl's mouth, and
the kids are animated now. They weren't
before. Oh, that's right. Everything's animated. It's like, again, like the Phantom Tollbooth. They switch from live action to animation. And it is interesting that the kids acknowledge this, because when they first see Timer, they say, "You're a cartoon." And Timer says, "I could be on Saturday morning TV, but I'm not."
Like, oh, maybe that's why they didn't show this anymore, because now he was on Saturday morning TV and it would be incorrect.
Yeah, they didn't want to make Timer into a liar. So Timer makes them small, and they're all inside Uncle Carl, and they are fighting decay germs in his mouth. That's what they call cavities.
Yeah.
Which I assume is probably to kind of keep it cohesive when later on they're talking about actual germs, even though a lot of...
Because as I understand, it's not that germs attack your teeth, it's acid.
Yes. That's right, it's the waste products of germs, isn't it?
Yes.
Or whatever it is.
Yes.
I don't know.
This way, you have this little animated germ swinging away with his hammer, singing this chip, 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 chip song. So that way, you don't have to have a germ, you know, wiping his butt on Uncle Carl's teeth and going poop, 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 poop.
They use some artistic license.
Yes. Yes, this is one of those things where they have to talk about the digestion of food, but never actually discuss where it goes.
No, they're a little, it's a little... yes, they're a little coy about stuff. I was amused at because last week we were discussing the idea of, you know, those Christian isekai movies, and like applying them to things that are not usually just Christian allegories. And we talked about dental hygiene, and then that's what they did. They pretty much did it here.
Well, that's why I suggested this one.
Oh yeah, that's right. I mean, they don't just do dental hygiene. They do a lot. We learn about all the ways that the body can be abused in this special.
Yes. Eating badly, smoking, not doing drugs. Drugs never comes up in this unless you count. Drinking doesn't come up either. So it's basically about eat the right foods, don't smoke, and treat your cuts.
Yes. Well, it is 1973, so I guess drugs weren't a big issue yet.
Was there a war on drugs yet?
Let's see. This is pre-Reagan, so I mean,
I
think
Reagan, but it's not pre-Nixon, is it?
That's true. No, I think drugs were bad, but maybe they hadn't decided to start. You know, they hadn't really the Reagan push hadn't started, so maybe. Nixon hadn't figured out the power of television. That's right. He never figured out the power of television. That's why he lost against Kennedy.
That's right, because he came on dressed in rags and was scratching himself with a bone the whole time.
Yeah.
And he found out that they could see him. What?
Yeah. That's right. Everyone's like, well, who do you want to vote for? Smiling Jack or this railway hobo? And America was like, Smiling Jack. We learn about, but so we do learn. Yeah, I was interested that there is an anti-smoking bit in this because, it's one of those things where I don't know much about the history of tobacco in this country, but it's interesting that like it seems like it was pretty uncontroversial in 1973 to just say like smoking is bad for you; it makes your lungs not work, and which is interesting.
I wonder if this is why if. Things like this started getting a toehold and the tobacco industry started fighting back.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Cause it's like, I know that for years they were muddying the waters, you know, just like anti-climate change, people are doing now.
More study is needed.
Yeah, exactly. Like that was the tobacco industry line for like years and years and years I think it wasn't even into the 90s, to be honest. I don't know why I'm guessing. I don't know anything, but it's just interesting in this early 70s special, just saying like, oh yeah, that's a thing. It's bad.
There's a little bit of a comics connection because you know about how much of the leak that proved that when they swore cigarettes were not harmful, they knew how harmful cigarettes were. It came in a package signed Mr. Butts.
Really?
Yeah, this is true.
Wow. we saw his commercials even.
Yep.
So there is a connection there. There's a lot going on here. Also, I feel like Timer is like when they go to the lungs where they meet Sad Sack.
Yes.
The sad air sac, I guess.
Yes, the lungs is this a large open space, obviously, where you have all these friendly, smiling, balloon-like creatures who are air sacs, and then you have this one, deflated, lumpy one sitting sadly by himself called Sad Sack, who has been damaged by tobacco use.
Yeah, and you can tell tobacco is really harmful because it injured one out of the millions of air sacs in Uncle Carl's lungs.
Yeah. Like, you know, one at a time? Is that how it works?
Apparently. Well, also then they say that, like, and they have a song, and they say that the Sad Sack mentions that Uncle Carl started smoking when he was like 15.
Yeah.
And so I just feel like, you know what, Timer, you really waited a little too long to try and warn about the dangers of smoking, because like 40 odd years, I think the damage is done.
Yeah. Timer, why didn't you do this with Uncle Carl's mother?
Yeah. Frankly, I mean, Timer's a little late on everything in this, because it's like, oh, yeah, his diet is really bad. He's like, you realize that's not okay. By the time you're in your 50s, I mean, you know, you've been eating for your whole life. I mean, you probably wanted to set these good habits a little earlier, yeah. You know? I mean, it's never too late to change, but it's just, you know, just it's better. It's, if you've got an animated circadian rhythm who knows these things, you know, he should be a little more proactive, is what I'm saying.
Yeah. The tobacco industry would like to debate the previous statement. It is, in fact, too late to change. Keep smoking.
Well, you know, now just vape. That's fine.
Yeah, that's totally fine. Yeah, there's, you know, that's a case where more study really is needed, for real this time.
That's right. Wink, wink.
Oh, but don't forget that when they meet Sad Sack, there is a brief moment of some sort of hideous miasma covered in eyes floating by, and Timer takes off his hat and hides Sad Sack underneath it until it passes. And this is our first glimpse at it, which is a kind of unnamed threat that they never quite explain until the very end.
Yeah, I just thought it was, you know, Carl smoking, but...
but no, we keep seeing it.
Yeah, it comes up again. We do see Carl smoking and some smoke in the lungs, but that's... But it is a different thing, though related. So where do they go from the lungs? I think they just... Don't they go... They go to the heart.
I think from there... They go to the heart? Yeah, I think they do. This is... Let me scoot a little forward and see. Oh, they ride down the bloodstream, and this is where, yeah, on this riverboat with a southern colonel at the helm, and this is where we get to the moment that just grabbed me for this, where he's looking through his telescope and he goes, "Uh-oh, fatty gorillas."
Yeah. They didn't really look like gorillas to me.
No, I'm guessing he meant gorillas.
They didn't really much look like that either, to be honest.
They are is fatty deposits that make the bloodstream narrower, but they do manage to get through.
Yes, they are like, it's basically this big, like, kind of clump of things, like a big pile of things that kind of look like, I mean, they've got eyes. They kind of look like manatees or tardigrades crossed.
Yeah, they look a little bit like the lethargians all piled up.
Yes, yeah. We don't get a really good look at them because they just kind of, they don't do much other than block the way. They're trying to
narrow block the way, but as they're blocking the way, it sails by again, cackling.
Yes. So, but they manage to get through, and they're on their way to their heart, and the heart is... this little guy, he's kind of on a big like pile of veins that are almost like beanbags for him.
Yeah, he's got a face kind of like Ziggy.
Yeah, and the music of the, not music, but the thumping of the heartbeat. For some reason, the whole thing, I was like, oh, this whole thing just feels like a hippie opium den. Something about that beat going on. I was like, I think I remember this song from Hair. But then Timer just is like, oh, yeah, that's the heart, and just starts insulting how the heart is too fat.
I don't think, you know, I guess the heart might get fatty deposits. I'm not really sure.
Yeah,
but I don't think the heart itself becomes fat.
Yeah, I don't really think that's how it works. but yeah, this heart does have a song, though, saying to have a heart.
Yeah, he has the Have a Heart song, and then we get during his Have a Heart song, Uncle Carl is carrying a TV into the bedroom. Now, kids, TVs didn't used to be light and flat. They used to be, you know, 200-pound boxes. So this is a very difficult thing for Uncle Carl to do, especially. And the heart is like, you know, he's bringing the TV into the bedroom because he says he deserves to relax. What about me?
Yeah, and then they're saying if only Uncle Carl exercised regularly instead of once in a while like this, then, you know, it wouldn't be such a strain on his heart. You know, and I mean, they really show the heart straining in this. This special really kind of illustrates the dangers of ill health in a pretty graphic way.
At first I was like, do we want to do this one for our Halloween week? But no, this is appropriate.
Yeah. I mean, you know, if I saw this when I was a kid, I would probably be pretty scared. you know, I probably would be scared off of smoking.
There's nothing on the level of the greedy in this. The animation isn't that good, but
nothing that would lead me. I would watch this film and have like, you know, develop a bad fetish from it. I would just watch it and be like, be kind of scared, you know, but it doesn't really rise to the level of traumatizing me into like getting a new kink.
Okay. Yeah. From the heart, they end up falling onto the spinal cord. They end up on the spine, and this is when the kids start saying, we want you to take us home.
That's, yeah, they're sick of this shit.
they are really tired, and it's not even halfway over. So I feel like I kind of got confused as to what the point of all of this was.
Yeah, because then, Timer just keeps saying, oh, yeah, I'll totally take you home. We got to go through the liver first. Oh, no, we got to go through, you know, kidneys. He just takes them all over the place, you know. But he's ostensibly taking them towards home, towards out, I guess. But, you know, it's like, oh, how are they going to get out? What orifice are they going to leave? Are they going to exit through? That's the question.
Knowing Uncle Carl, I'm guessing it's an enlarged facial pore.
Now, is it a spinal cord where they meet these two characters?
One of them is like a neuron, and the other one, I have no idea. She's like, I mean, she's kind of shaped like a brain or an ear. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. Her name is Gloria. And Gloria. She's got this very kind of husky Rita Hayworth type voice.
Yeah.
And then the other guy's what, like Otto von Neuron or something?
Yeah, he's this kind of, you know, Kaiser-esque World War I German guy in super tall boots that go all the way up to his crotch. And he and Timer look very similar, except that, yes, he's got the Pickelhauber on.
Yeah, that was kind of just, I was trying to figure out. It was like, I feel like whatever it was, you know, Otto von Neuron isn't really much of a pun at all. It's just like, oh, you just put a German name on Neuron, you know.
But it's like, okay, Len Maxwell, what or accents can you do? German? Yeah. Okay.
Like if it was me, like, first of all, don't make him like full on Hitler and be like, I'm just coming back from the Nuremberg trials.
Oh, ouch.
Oh no, actually Hitler was dead by then. Who went to the Nuremberg trials? I don't know, Goering probably? Yeah,
Goering.
I don't know, a bunch of them. A bunch of the other ones, who knows? But anyway, yeah, there's really no reason for there to have like a, yeah, like you said, this weird Prussian soldier guy, other than I guess he could do a German accent. And
he is a lot like Timer. He even sings some of Timer's songs.
Yeah. And Gloria doesn't do anything. She just
shows up and kisses him and makes him blush. She's,
yeah,
she's kind of the Uncle Carl equivalent of Birdo.
Yeah. yeah, I can see it. But like, I think they pretty much, what is the problem? I thought that we were going to get something where it's like, oh, Uncle Carl needs to stretch it more because his spine is all crooked or something. But I don't think they really go into that. They basically generally say they don't have
this is what the spinal cord does. Yeah, they don't really talk about any actual problems of the spinal cord. They're just there.
Yeah. I mean, I guess it's like, look, we got to travel on the spinal cord to get to they were on the heart and they're going to go next to the stomach, and I guess you hit the spinal cord on the way, I suppose.
No, I guess so.
I mean, I'm no anatomist, but that's the way it be. They just tell us what the spinal cord does. It moves information from your brain to the rest of your body. So good to know.
Well, I guess they wanted to give you some anatomical information that wasn't shaking your finger at you.
Yeah. Yeah. So as they used to say on AFN PSAs when I was a kid, your spine, where to good health.
But now we're getting to Timer's real, what you know Timer from, which is dietary advice. They go to the stomach, which is represented as like this overstuffed bagpipe.
Yes.
And then we meet the guy who's in charge of the stomach. This is my favorite character. He is so weird. What is going on with this guy? It's Herbie the hippie.
Yeah, he's like this kind of spider looking thing.
Yeah, he looks like a spider version of Cookie Monster, and he talks with a hippie voice.
Yeah.
Or like a beatnik voice. Yeah, man.
That's right. And he doesn't like having jobs, but Timer got him this job as like basically being in charge of the stomach, I guess.
Wow, do you think he's like gut flora?
I mean,
he's like a helpful bacterium. Wow.
Well, what else? I mean, what would you be if you're in the stomach? Like digestive acid or I don't know what, maybe.
Yeah, he seems to be in charge of keeping the acid flowing. He's running around like an over busy superintendent trying to keep everyone's hot water on.
Yeah. So he's running around like twisting a lot of valves and things and being upset because Uncle Carl is eating too much.
To be fair, Uncle Carl does have, he has a very varied diet, but it's all a variation of bad things.
Yes. But then the kids are there. Oh, I think we forgot to mention Joe got lost somehow. But
he hasn't gotten lost yet.
Oh, he hasn't. I thought that he had gotten lost and this is what they found him again. Or maybe...
No. Joe is still with them at the time.
Okay.
Then we get yet another song, and we get to see Uncle Carl sitting at the table with like 20 bowls piled around him eating. And I'm just struck by how much he looks like Rush Limbaugh.
Well, you know, in 1973, all 50-year-old guys look the same.
What if he's not 50? What if this is what 40-year-olds looked like at the time?
I mean, I wouldn't put it past him, honestly. He's got a terrible diet. He's a heavy smoker. He's clearly, that stuff ages you faster. So he could very well be, in his 40s at this point.
Yeah, it only took 4 years of Trump to put white on my face.
Yeah. So. Oh, man. Are we being too mean to Hal Smith?
He played a drunk all his life. He's used to looking haggard. It's what they hired him for.
Yeah, I mean he's got a look, I guess you could say the look is if you were like, look, we got to cast a guy in a hell short. His name's Uncle Carl, and he's been smoking since he's 15, and every meal involves like 80 courses. This is the guy, and you hire this guy. It's like, well, it's what you'd expect, and actually, I just looked him up. The actor Hal Smith was actually 57 when this was.
Oh, okay.
So he doesn't look.
Yeah. Maybe he's he's their great uncle or something.
Yeah. So I guess for his age, he doesn't look terrible.
You're right. At 50, for 50, that would be pretty bad. For 57, he's looking pretty good, actually.
Yeah. Yeah. But also he's got additional problems because he's got a really bad temper too, we learn later.
Yes.
But anyway, so this hippie spider, Herbie, is all upset because they have a little song about all the stuff that Uncle Carl eats. And this one's kind of a bop, honestly.
Yeah.
I kind of like the song.
It's got that kind of like the chicken rail, cartoon eating music.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So, you know, it's very catchy. It's also interesting when they look inside, they have a porthole so they can look inside on the cross stomach, like one of those cows. And yeah. And it's like all just like a bunch of, I actually expected the whole thing to be like, oh, like, you know, whole tin cans and apple cores and stuff. But it is like goo. It's like a lot of different colored goo. Though later on in the show, in the song, they do have the standard, you know, whole foods that have clearly not been chewed.
And a lot of it is on fire, too.
Yes, which I guess makes sense. You know, acid? Maybe yeah, that's if the show?
If the stomach has any kind of factory role in the body, it's kind of like a, like an incinerator. So yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So they have this song, and we get to see Uncle Carl, like live action Uncle Carl, eating like, you know, corn on the cob, doing the typewriter thing.
Yeah, eating corn on the cob and a chicken fried steak and more corn with green beans. So he has a very corn heavy diet. But like any American.
Yeah, yeah. Man, no, it's making me hungry just thinking about it. All that corn.
Corn.
I could go for some corn, but...
Is it grass?
It's a grass. That's yes. It's a grass. So that's why it's good for you.
That's why grass is good for you. That this has been a health tip from North Korea.
Yeah. What is he? So I guess I can't remember. I just watched this literally like half an hour ago, and I've already forgotten what happens in this part. Do they just leave?
There's like some sort of explosion, and they all get separated.
Oh, that's right. I think because Uncle Carl burps.
Yeah, Uncle Carl burps, and it sends everyone flying. And now we have a song from the little girl, and this is not a song about Uncle Carl. We're worried about you. We wish you'd take care of yourself. No, it's about I want to go home.
Yeah, I don't think they've even at this point in the special, I don't think the kids even really grokked that this is all about Uncle Carl's like failing health.
Yeah, they're just, well, I mean, they're, it's very accurate look at how children are exclusively concerned with their own comfort at all times.
I mean, yeah, how true.
They have true. To be, you know, the TV has to be nearby or else they're going to start complaining.
I mean, she literally says she misses her TV in this song, doesn't she?
Yeah, she misses her dog and her TV and her cat and her parakeet. I was like, yeah. This girl was like six. Who gave her a parakeet?
It is funny because at one point, Timer is all like, you kids really love Uncle Carl. And it's like, yeah, you really got that impression?
You think?
I guess they seem to, you know... But
we love Uncle Carl. His second wife drives us everywhere.
Oh, Mildred. but yeah, so they get separated, and there's this weird thing about how they're hiding from the brain this whole time.
Yeah, the brain is like, you know, for some reason Timer is concerned because if the brain detects that foreign bodies, like these two children's bodies, are in Uncle Carl, he'll send, I guess, white blood cells to take care of them. But as it turns out, the white blood cells are all busy fighting a war in Uncle Carl's hand.
Yeah. I actually thought it was weird because I missed the thing about the blood cells. And I just thought that meant that if the brain finds out, Uncle Carl is going to have like a panic attack. Because he'll be like, oh shit, they're children inside my body. Like, you know.
And his wife is like, now you know how I felt.
Yeah. But he, so there's a war going on in Uncle Carl's hand, left hand, which is where Joe is, apparently. So
yeah, I don't know how Joe got, he got burped into the hand. I mean, I've burped and it went up my nose, but have you ever burped and it goes up your arm? Ugh.
I have to say that the way that they explain the body, because I've seen a lot of these cartoons where they do the, oh, you go inside the body, right? Mm-hmm. I think every cartoon does that amazing journey or incredible journey parody at some point.
Yeah, the incredible journey is when you have like three animals make their way home. Fantastic Voyage. That was
Fantastic Voyage. That's the one I'm thinking. Yes.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I know the Rugrats did it. I know the Muppet Babies did it.
They did it on Transformers. Come on.
Oh, there you go. I feel like usually you go to the parts of the body that are like organs, you know, you're usually inside them. Usually you don't go to meet them
as characters. Yeah.
Yeah. You don't go to the hand. It's like the hand doesn't really have a cavity in it that you can walk inside. I think even kids are like, I don't know about that.
We're going to the hand.
Yeah. It's like, this is very sus, as the kids would say. So they go to the hand where Uncle Carl, he has a cut that he did not, I guess. Well, I don't know. They show him bandaging it, but they imply, I guess, that he must have not taken care of it.
Yeah, he didn't use antiseptic or something, and it's a very ragged-looking bandage. And, yeah, it looks kind of green and dirty. So I can definitely see this as being like, you know, that he's, you know, he did the bare minimum and his hand is getting worse.
Yeah. I mean, having been in that situation, like, you know, yeah, I get it, you know. I once got, like, a cut on my leg from Coral. And I was like, yeah, it's fine. Just pour some water on it. It'll be totally fine, you know? And, you know, like, and like a few days, 4 days later, I'm like, yeah, so my entire leg is like all swollen up and it's like leaking like white stuff. But I'm sure it'll be fine. You know, I'm sure it's going to be fine. So I had to be on like antibiotics for like a month after that. Two rounds, actually, because the first one didn't kill whatever it was. It was extremely like nasty. Don't cut yourself on coral is my recommendation. It's bad.
I'm assuming you're swimming.
I was, yes, I was in the water at the time. You know,
you weren't just playing in the dried coral at the Monterey Bay Aquarium's gift shop.
No, I was snorkeling at the time, and coral is full of all sorts of weird bacteria. And then you cut it and you're in the ocean, which is all full of all sorts of fish poop. So, you know.
Do not forget that we have a bloodstream because it replaced the ocean going through us.
Yes. So it was not a good scene. It was like, I'll just pour some of this water on. I'm sure it'll be fine. Because, you know, it was like, what's the worst that can happen? It's a cut. Yeah. Turns out, yeah, it's actually, yeah, don't get cuts. They're not like Uncle Carl did. He got a cut and he almost died.
He almost died from his cut. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, also keep in mind that I think a normal cut, generally that's not going to happen so much, you know, like this was, I think, an unusual situation with a coral, bacteria infusion. But anyway, back to Uncle Carl. There's an army of germs and an army of white blood cells, and they're gonna fight.
Yeah, they don't say that they're white blood cells. They just look like fat yellow guys, but that's obviously what they are.
Yeah, and their leader is like, what's his name, General Antigen? I don't know.
General Antigen. Yeah, we saw him earlier in The Teeth. He was the one. Yeah. He had a sidekick that was helping him fight off mouth germs. But, he seems to be, more important to this story than Timer is, because the kids actually risk their lives to save General Antigen's life.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he's a lot less annoying than Timer.
Yeah, he is.
He at least, his theme is, he's kind of like, I don't know what you would call this sort of guy, kind of like a cavalry type soldier, like very
yeah, kind of a
Custer.
Robert E. Lee character.
Robert, yeah. He's got a big bushy mustache, you know. The kids risk their life to save him and defeat the evil germs that were like covering everything in green goo.
Yes, and while this is happening, the it has been hovering over them, cackling louder and louder. And this is where they ask, well, what is the it? And he says, well, it's got a lot of names, but you might know it best as the Last Hurrah or the Grim Reaper or Death.
It's like pretty fucking metal.
Yeah.
I mean,
that is a cool representation of death, a cackling miasma of eyeballs.
I mean, it is. It's just, it's pretty intense for like, a children's cartoon about with a Dancing Lemon. but yeah, like I said, I don't know. I would have been able to handle this if I was when I was a kid. I would have been too scared. but yeah, it's definitely, well, you know what I mean? I guess you want kids to really take this seriously, you know? You want them to understand health is no laughing matter, even if Timer's doing vaudeville impressions.
Now, unfortunately, your niece and nephew aren't going to be able to go into your body and fight off your germs for you.
Yeah, you got to do it yourself, I guess. I mean, you got to do it as a big person, fighting your own germs, not like tiny into your own body. But around this, is this the time though? I think like the Hart's having trouble now because Uncle Carl gets really mad.
Yeah, Uncle Carl gets really mad and his heart starts beating faster and he starts smoking, so which is about to finish off Sad Sack and all of the other air sacks say goodbye to him. And
yeah, but then luckily the plumbing leak puts out the cigarettes, so everything is saved.
Yeah, what a great coincidence.
Yeah, man, like it's Uncle Carl is really just like he's trying to do this job and he's just like really... his stress level is through the roof.
Especially Uncle Carol is very, very kind of, oh crap, what's his name? All in the Family.
Yeah, Archie Bunker.
Yes, he's very Archie Bunkerish.
Yeah, I mean, you know, he's a very specific kind of possibly like pre-70s dude.
Yeah, you know what he is? He's a lodge guy. You can definitely see him like sitting around with a fez on. He looks like he's like George Licker.
Yes, 100%. That's it. Lodge guy. George Licker. No, yeah, you got it. He is
an older conservative guy that you would love if you knew him, but there's so much shit wrong with him.
Yes, that's the best way to put it. And he's like mad. He's mad at his useless wife, Mildred, for bringing him the wrong bucket, you know? and it's just, this guy can't win. It's also funny because at this during this like timer saying like Uncle Carl should be calm like me, so
as he's freaking out.
Yeah, it's like okay, sorry, not all of us are as dead as you, timer. Fuck off. I mean, what are they supposed to, like? It's one thing they're like, okay, kids, you have to go tell Carl to like eat better and not smoke. Okay, also tell him to never be mad. Yeah, that's a little harder. I mean,
tell him not to have accidents and cut himself.
Yeah, it's like, okay. I feel like there's like a whole bunch of different health messages being crammed into this that like maybe we should have just stuck with one, you know?
So what, are you saying that this should have been like a series or a mini series?
Perhaps a series of short PSAs.
Yeah.
If only someone had thought to do that with Timer. then they finally, I believe, after this, they meet the brain, don't they?
Yes, they finally meet the brain, and it looks like the surprise is going to be that Timer is himself the brain, but then it turns out they're separate characters anyway.
Yeah, the brain is kind of interesting, because they're kind of like in this, I guess this like, this almost like cathedral of gray matter.
Yeah, and it's like a necropolis of brain.
Yeah, and you like the voice of the brain, you hear it and it's kind of like these you almost see like electrical sparks when it happens, which makes sense.
The brain does work on electrical impulses to some extent.
Yeah. I mean, it's actually kind of a neat representation. I kind of like this, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, if there's one thing to recommend this, it's the visuals.
Yeah. There's a lot to watch, a lot to see in this. A lot of interesting stuff.
And the brain has this very calm, gentle voice. And he even reprimands a Timer when Timer makes a terrible joke.
Yeah, he's like, Timer, you should be ashamed of yourself.
Timer's joke is, I should know. I come from a whole family of long livers. Really? Yeah, my uncle had a liver this long.
Yeah. It's a pretty bad joke. Timer has, the brain's voice sounds a lot like the voice of God in the Hermy and Wormy cartoons. Probably the voice of God in any Christian cartoon, to be honest, which kind of makes sense. I mean, the brain is kind of like a godlike figure in the body, you know?
Yeah, it wasn't until about 2000 that we started, you know, ever representing God as a black guy.
Oh, was there ever a black god?
Bruce Almighty.
Oh, that's true. That's true. I forgot about that.
And a couple of years later, there was that Muppet Christmas movie where Whoopi Goldberg played God.
I didn't realize that there was a Muppet Christmas movie with God in it.
Yes, it's called It's a Very Merry Muppet Christmas Movie. And what it is it's Kermit doing the It's a Wonderful Life thing where he sees a world where he's never been born.
Oh, I bet it sucks.
Well, let's see.
The world without Kermit, not the movie. Sorry.
Well, for one thing, the world without Kermit has an incredibly muscular Beaker who's working the door at a funky club, and Bunsen is dancing in one of the cages.
Okay, actually, maybe not so bad after all.
And Fozzie steals his wallet.
Oh, jeez. All right, I feel like I need to watch this movie.
It's an interesting movie.
So I think at this point, this is where they reveal to the kids that everything in this journey was actually planned.
It wasn't an accident that Uncle Carl swallowed them. They wanted to, give the kids this information because they knew that Uncle Carl would listen to them, which I don't think proves to be the case.
No, they tell everyone what you saw in here, although adults don't listen. And it's like, well, okay.
You should have done this to an adult.
You should have had
Mildred go inside her husband's body.
Yeah, or possibly Timer. Why don't you just talk to Uncle Carl himself? I mean,
yeah, Carl, come with me inside your own body. Whoa, meta.
Yeah, I mean, feel like Timer, I feel like Timer could do it. But anyway, so they basically say, this is the part where I guess they're like, it's weird because they've had the thing with death hovering over, but they're kind of coy about this. They just kind of say like, oh, show everyone how much life could be worth living. It's like, all right.
Yeah, and not they don't specifically say because you don't want death to come too soon.
Yeah, yeah. But
so
I guess
they talk their way around poop, and then they talk their way around death, even though they were, frank enough to even say the word at a time when, TV never used to say die when I was a kid. I mean, it was always, we could be destroyed.
Yep. It's like,
finished.
Someone could shoot my plane, and then luckily I would parachute to safety right before the plane crashes. Make sure to put that in.
Whenever they referred to death on Muppet Babies, it was just somebody doing the finger across the neck gesture.
Oh, yeah. I remember that. Oh, I didn't realize that was because they weren't allowed to talk about death. Huh, interesting. But anyway, so the kids emerge from Uncle Carl. I can't remember. How do they get out?
Yeah, they just kind of magically appear outside of him after a big musical number that features the entire cast of The Country of Uncle Carl. And then we have a reprise of the Little Girls I Want to Go Home song with Timer's Welcome to the Country of Uncle Carl song. As they walk through, acres and acres of blood vessels and things that look like they came from Fantastic Planet, which Hal Smith was also in. And and finally they walk out of they walk out of his mouth.
Oh, okay, sure, why not?
As Timer waves a tearful goodbye to them and is like, really? You knew each other for like 30 minutes.
Yeah, and you spent the whole time complaining that, this crazy guy wouldn't let you go home.
Well, it's gotta be lonely being a circadian clock. I mean, nobody listens to you.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. But now
we should be in bed, but we're doing this.
Yeah, I will never sleep. I'll sleep when I'm dead. So they're out, and they wake up Uncle Carl. And they're all like, "Oh, girl, go! We were inside you.
We went inside your body." And he's just mowing down pretzels. He's like, "Oh, really? Did you have a good time?"
Yeah, I kind of love that. Yeah, and as they're like doing that, he literally picks up a piece of cake and just starts shoveling in his mouth. And like that's how it ends. I mean, I guess it's realistic, but like, I'm like, geez, okay.
I think he takes a slug of whiskey too.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I guess they want to like, they want to emphasize like, look, you know, it's not an instantaneous transformation, but I mean, come on, it's for kids. You'd think they would give a little more of a, you know, a little more hopeful ending than like Uncle Grandma. Though I do think him going, oh, you have fun, as he's just like shoveling pretzels in. It is extremely funny.
I mean, pretzels are hardly the worst thing you can eat. I mean, sure, they're all carbs, but they're fat-free.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, pretzels are pretty, like, innocuous, because whenever they tell you, whenever you're doing any diet, and they're all, like, healthy snacks, they always mention pretzels, you know? So, I mean, I suppose they're as healthy as you can really get if you're doing a carb, you know?
Well, this is a pretty... This is pretty low res. Maybe he's like, you know, shoveling them into a big thing of cheese dip first. I can't tell.
Oh, maybe. Well, I feel like that's the thing is like, if you're going to like, you know, if you're going to snack, yeah, pretzels are a good way to go because otherwise, or nuts, I guess, because like, no, or like when they always tell you like, oh, try like, you know, like baby carrots. Yeah, no, no, I'm not doing that shit. Fuck off. Nobody's doing that.
Well, no, you know, you should do.
What?
Well, what you should do is get some juice, like orange juice or apple juice or pomegranate juice or whatever turns you on, and pour it into a ice cube tray. And then you cover that with aluminum foil and stick popsicle sticks through and freeze it overnight. And then you've got sunshine on a stick.
Whoa, I'm going to write this down. I would go for that.
Yeah.
Maybe some wagon wheels, too. So Ethan, you saw this when you were a kid. How did you feel? So how was it revisiting the magical, fantastical joy voyage?
The incredible, indelible, fantastical. Damn, I said it wrong. The incredible, indelible, magical, physical mystery trip. No, I didn't see this as a kid. I only knew Timer from the shorts, just like you.
Oh, okay. I thought for some reason I thought you saw this when you were actually younger. So this is
now,
the first
I
time...
saw this when I was young. I did see this when I was younger, like 3 or 4 months younger.
So... Oh! So never mind. how does it compare to the Timer shorts, I guess?
Well, I like his later voice better. I mean, Len Maxwell isn't, you know, he's not terrible, but I don't really like him in the role of Timer.
Yeah, agreed. Not his fault, but I think they really... The character was just not as likable in this iteration.
No.
I don't know how much we could really be said to like Timer in his other iterations, but he at least doesn't have time to do all these like awful like songs and skits like he did.
Yeah. Apparently, Len Maxwell was the original voice for Punchy from Hawaiian Punch.
Oh, wow. I guess he was busy.
Yeah.
Well, good for him. You got to make a living.
I have one question. Is Uncle Carl raising these kids?
It's kind of unclear, isn't it?
Yeah, are they just visiting him, or is it, or is Uncle Carl their caretaker and it's really in their best interest to keep him healthy? And if he is, did their parents not have a Timer of their own who could have helped their kids save their lives?
Oh shit.
And what about these kids? Do they have their own Timer? Can Uncle Carl's Timer come hang out with their Timers?
Everyone's got their own Timer, I guess.
It's a puzzling world.
It's a little Timer in all of us.
he's very small, yes.
Yeah, just wait till, I guess if need be, like, he'll come out and take some random children and put them in you.
What a great way to kidnap children. Just have your circadian clock do it for you.
Yeah, exactly. They'll never know.
Now that's a super villain.
We're giving people ideas. So we got a lot of listeners out there who are like, I really want to kidnap children, but I just can't figure out how to do it. And they listen to
it. It turns out Timer is Q.